to. First of all, I must apologize because due to my almost legendary laziness, I didn't prepare a PowerPoint presentation, so I will only read my paper. When reading the German's the Viris Illustribus for the first time, one easily recognized some familiar features of common service dealing with the first, often legendary steps of the Christian Church. Peter crucified head downwards, Lucas physician, as well as close association of Mark and Peter and Paul and Luke, are all common places in traditional church historiography. At the second group, of course, it becomes clear that almost every single of the before-mentioned details traces its origin from the Eusebius pioneering church history, making the allure of the Viris Illustribus much smaller. It is almost impossible to determine precisely whether and when generations of Western Christians found explanations of their historical beginnings in Jerome or directly in Eusebius. In the second case, of course, in the Rufinus translation. But then again, the third group reveals that although Jerome depended heavily on the Bishop of Caesarea in compiling his lexicon for the first 250 years, the Viris Illustribus still emerged in a fruitful dialogue with the Greek text, as was recently, for instance, convincingly shown by Irene San Pietro, to whose insights my paper is partly indebted. Not only were its encyclopedic nature and brevity certain advantage for Jerome in comparison to Eusebius. More important is that although chiefly Eusebius speaks through the first 70 or so entries in the Viris Illustribus, Jerome is the one who is selecting when and what does he speak about. And it can be argued that it was Jerome's selection which decisively shaped some common features of the self-image of the Christian Church in the West regarding the first 250 years of its history. Regarding the apostolic age, we already mentioned some biographical details of apostles, which used to find entries in literally every textbook of church history until the last decades. Jerome influentially enriched the data found in Eusebius by stating the exact year of Peter and Paul's execution in Rome, pointing to the year 67 AD. He also wrote, Peter served as bishop of Rome for 25 years, which later constituted a common church in the West. In a quite direct contradiction to Eusebius' statement that Ignatius was the second bishop of Antioch, leading the local church thereafter Evodius, Jerome maintains Ignatius was Antiochene Ecclesiae Tertius post Pastrum Apostolum Episcopus, thereby influencing the veneration of Chair of St. Peter in Antioch in the West, which since the Middle Ages and until 1960 was even celebrated on the more prominent date of the 22nd of February, leaving to the Chair of St. Peter in Rome only the 18th of January. Following the footsteps of Eusebius, the Viris Illustribus further certainly helped to establish two powerful traditions concerning the composition of both Gospel of John and the Acts. Regarding the latter, already Eusebius and Jerome after him placed Luke's word to Rome in time between the alleged two processes against Paul under Nero, thus explaining the unpleasant fact that the author of the Acts omits mentioning of his hero's death in the capital. As for the Gospel of John, Eusebius and Jerome advanced the theory that the beloved disciple began to write his Gospel since he felt the mission of Jesus was indirectly represented in the three synoptic predecessors, putting emphasis on the first 2 years of his existence. It can be argued that problematic Jewish-Christian relations are much less emphasized in the Viris Illustribus than in church history of Eusebius, to make the front against the Jews one of the pillars of his narrative. Jerome not only included Philo and Joseph's frameworks into his lexicon with quite sizable entries, what didn't go unnoticed even in his lifetime, but also dedicated a disproportionately long text to James, the brother of the Lord, who was arguably the most Jewish of the apostles. Here he, of course, chiefly repeated the Eusebius and Hieronymus story, which can be deemed interesting by itself. But still, the prominent place given to James is not self-evident at all, particularly since Jerome denies the authenticity of the letter of James, even more resolutely than the Bishop of Syria, saying about it quite explicitly, Ipsa ab alio polam sub nomine eis edita asseritur, licet paulatum tempore procedente, obtinuerit autoritatem. Regarding the relationship between the early church and Roman authorities, the Viris Illustribus are broadly again a reflection of Eusebius' views. But on the other hand, it seems to me that the theme of the pre-Constantinian centuries as a period of an almost constant persecution remains quite marginal for the most part. Jerome, in connection with Apollonius, whom he describes as a Roman senator, which Eusebius does not, and as a pioneer of Christian writing in Latin, mentioned that the adherence to Christianity was a crime per se. It is true that Jerome holds to the sin of the 10 persecutions, which is reflected in the information that Ignatius of Antioch died persecutionem commovente Traianum, whereas Cyprian was martyred during persecutione octava. Conversely, the later influential narratives on martyrdoms of virtually all apostles and Roman bishops are likely absent from the Viris Illustribus. From these two groups, only Peter, Paul, both apostles named James, as well as the Roman bishop Fabian, are explicitly declared martyrs in the period under Theodosius, although Jerome mentions the succession of many other Roman bishops as well. The catalogue of the hierarch who died during the Decian persecution is longer, mainly in line with Eusebius, but even there, Jerome omits the explicit description of his chief hero Origen, directing his readers immediately to the bishop of Caesarea. In connecting Origen to the Emperor Philip the Arab, he influentially expands Eusebius' note that this emperor was already Christian by some reports to the certainty since, according to him, he primus deus Romanus Christianus. Regarding the inner life of the church as well as lines of thought inside it, German selection of Eusebius' material and his additions to it undoubtedly helped to form the canon of Western church history. First of all, Jerome proves to be the main source for the biographical crumbs concerning the first Latin writing theologians, even for the pre-Constantinian era. As San Pietro has shown, the Viris Illustribus even tries to somehow rehabilitate Tertullian, cementing his reputation with reference to Cyprian. Eusebius made reference to both African theologians and even quoted for Tertullian's work, but didn't dedicate separate section to their respective opus, as he did with many Greek writing colleagues of them. Jerome's description of Tertullian as presbyter was repeated until recently. The same is true for his statement that Minucius Felix was a lawyer. Secondly, since Origen is without question the leading personality of Jerome's lexicon, as he is for an important part of the church history of Eusebius, Jerome paid much attention to the development of Alexandrian Christianity and its catechetical school, thus giving for it a quite disproportionate place in most circles of ecclesiastical history, where the line Panthenus Clemens Origen forms one of the most familiar features of ancient Christianity. Perhaps this tendency goes even further and was one of the main reasons for Jerome to assign such a visible place to the evangelist Mark, and even more to Philo, who allegedly described the community founded by him in Alexandria. Since Eusebius made the front against the heretics a crucial, perhaps even the most visible pillar of his vision of the ecclesiastical history, heresies and refutation of them of course featured also in the Viris Illustribus. But it can be argued that there are some differences concerning emphases. The place of Gnostics is, for instance, much less pronounced than in Eusebius. Some Gnostic teachers are, of course, mentioned, and the Gospel of John 7 is said to be written against Cyrenius, but other departures from the rather doctrine are certainly more easily to notice for a reader. Unsurprisingly, many writers deserve it that entries by refuting Marcion and Marcionism. And Jerome didn't forget to repeat Eusebius' story about the meeting between Marcion and Polycarp in Rome. From the present day point of view, the attention to Montanism seems, on the other hand, perhaps disproportionate, both in Eusebius and Jerome, although this focus clearly shaped selections of themes in more modern service of church history style. One reason for Jerome to retain such a strong emphasis on authors who fought the Phrygian heresy would be his obvious affection for Tertullian. It is certainly interesting that he explicitly lists only his Montanistic characters, with the excuse that the other works are well known to everyone. Presbyter from Strinone even tries to exonerate Tertullian by blaming his defection to Montanists on contumelians played for Roman ecclesia. Another pretty obvious controversy in the Viris Illustribus is the one regarding the celebrating of Pasch. Here it seems to me that Jerome encounters the Asian position, which was later deemed dissident, with certain sympathy, which is in my opinion greater than in Eusebius. This is perhaps connected to the respect for John the Evangelist as the perceived founding father of the Christianity of Asia Minor, and is visible mainly in the long quote from Polycrates of Ephesus, who mobilized all the luminaries of Asian Church in the past to corroborate his conservative position. Jerome further lists the Roman Bishop Victor with his treatise on Pasch as one of the earliest Latin writings theologians, but on the other hand, he is not particularly fond of his unifying attempt, which tended nevertheless to be seen as an early sign of the working primacy of the Roman See, particularly, of course, in the Catholic Church historiography. Irenaeus' quite explicit critique of the bishop's action thus features prominently in the Viris Illustribus. Jerome also practically criticizes Millenarist views, but interestingly enough, he didn't mention Eusebius' identification of Papias of Hierapolis as pioneer of this conviction, also omitting Eusebius' pejorative description of him as a man of small intelligence. Maybe it was due to the importance of Papias as a source for the formation of apostolic traditions. Finally, author of the Viribus shows a keen interest in chronographers, enlarging Eusebius' information on both Julius Africanus and Hippolytus, although he still doesn't link the latter to Rome, as was the case in the first centuries. These are only some examples showing, in my opinion, how the main Eusebian material permitted into the historical memory of Western Christianity due to Jerome's editorial work and in characteristically Hieronymian disguise. Thank you.